Nice.
I'm gonna talk about clean, but I have to start off with a quotation from Roger Williams, who's acknowledged as the founder of Rhode Island. And the quotation has to do with clean and how we were part of it before it even became itself. So now against a prophecy. Oft have I heard these Indians say, these English will deliver us of all that's ours, our lands and lives. In the end, they will bereave us. My mission in life is to ensure that terrorism, greed, intolerance, and hypocrisy have a witness to their history and their legacy. My obligation is to speak for my ancestors who have paid with their blood for what little we may have today, and to hold on to it the best we can for our generations yet unborn. This is how we honor our ancestors, for we are the zoom lens that illuminates and magnifies what needs to be seen clearly within the culture of deception and denial that we are submerged in. Creator has a plan for each of us, each and every one that's born. It's into a plan the Creator has. We like to think we plan everything, but it's the Creator who really plans everything from cradle to the grave. And my voice normally isn't too loud. If anyone in that can't hear me, can you mind me something?
Can hear.
Okay, I'll have to raise my voice a little louder. Normally, if unless I'm angry, I don't speak loud. Some of what I have to say will make me angry. The Creator's plan is how He speaks to us. We are born with a purpose. We cross paths for a reason, because there are no accidents. Everything is part of the Creator's plan. All of you being here today, it's part of that plan. What role do we each have to play? That depends on the gifts we each have been blessed with and the choices we each make, or how we use those gifts to make this a better world. Hear all this in mind as you hear my words. Kakita. I'm going to start off with a brief history of the American Indian Movement that I had in my collection of papers. I can't even remember how or when it came into my possession, but anyone that's been in my home knows that I don't throw anything away.
Can you tell us if you can hear in the back now with the microphone? Because we can turn it up. I just didn't want to blast us out.
He's
going to talk.
Yeah. Can everyone hear me in the back?
More, a little bit higher.
A little higher?
Oh, yeah.
Okay, I'm going to get close.
I can definitely volunteer. I can be the mic stand.
In the 30 years of its formal history, the American Indian Movement, or AIM, has given witness to a great many changes. We say formal history because the movement existed for 500 years without a name. The leaders and members of today's AIM never fail to remember all of those who have traveled on before, having given their talent and their lives for the survival of the people. At the core of the movement is Indian leadership, under the direction of Negro Noe Weedon, Clyde H. Belcourt, and others making steady progress. The movement has transformed policy making into programs and organizations that have served Indian people in many communities. These policies have consistently been made in consultation with the spiritual leaders and elders. The success of these efforts is indisputable, but perhaps even greater than the accomplishment is the vision defining what AIM stands for. Indian people were never intended to survive the settlement of Europeans in the Western Hemisphere, our Turtle Island. With the strength of a spiritual base, AIM has been able to clearly articulate the claims of Native nations and has had the will and intellect to put forth those claims. The movement was founded to turn the attention of Indian people toward a renewal of spirituality, which would impart the strength of resolve needed to reverse the ruinous policies of the United States, Canada, and other colonialist governments of Central and South America. At the heart of AIM is deep spirituality and a belief in the connectedness of all Indian people. During the past 30 years, the American Indian Movement has organized communities and created opportunities for people across the Americas and Canada. AIM is headquartered in Minneapolis with chapters in many other cities, rural areas, and Indian nations. AIM has repeatedly brought successful suit against the federal government for the protection of the rights of Native nations, guaranteed in treaties, sovereignty, and the United States Constitution and laws. The philosophy of self-determination upon which the movement is built is deeply rooted in traditional spirituality, culture, language, and history. AIM develops partnerships to address the common needs of the people. Its first mandate is to ensure the fulfillment of treaties made with the United States. This is the clear and unwavering vision of the American Indian Movement. There has not been an easy path. Spiritual leaders and elders foresaw the testing of AIM's strength and stamina. Doubters, infiltrators, those who wished they were in the leadership, and those who didn't want to be, but wanted to tear down and take away, have had their turns. No one inside or outside the movement has so far been able to destroy the will and strength of AIM solidarity. Men and women, adults and children, are continuously urged to stay strong spiritually and to always remember that the movement is greater than the accomplishments or faults of its leaders. Inherent in the spiritual heart of AIM is knowing that the work goes on because the need goes on. Indian people live on Mother Earth with a clear understanding that no one will assure the coming generations except ourselves. No one from the outside will do this for us, and no person among us can do it all for us either. Self-determination must be the goal of all work, of all our work. Solidarity must be the first and only defense of the members. In November 1972, AIM brought a caravan of Native Nation representatives to Washington, D.C., to the place where dealings with Indians have taken place since 1849. I have to disagree with that because it's a little before that, before there was the United States. The U.S. Department of Interior AIM. Oh, my eyes aren't too good, I can't see where the periods are. AIM put the following claims directly before the President of the United States. One, restoration of treaty making, ended by Congress in 1871. Two, establishment of a treaty commission to make new treaties with sovereign Native nations. And three, Indian leaders to address Congress. Four, review of treaty commitments and violations. And five, the unratified treaties to go before the Senate. And six, all Indians to be governed by treaty relations. Relief, and seven, relief for Native nations for treaty rights violations. Eight, recognition of the rights of Indians to interpret treaties. And nine, joint congressional committees to to be formed on reconstruction of Indian relations. 10, restoration of 110 million acres of land taken away from Native nations by the United States. 11, restoration of terminated rights. 12, repeal of state jurisdiction on Native nations. 13, federal protection for offenses against Indians. 14, abolishment of the Bureau of Indian Affairs. 15, creation of a new Office of Federal Indian Relations. 16, new office to remedy breakdown in the constitutionally prescribed relationships between the U.S. and Native nations. 17, Native nations to be immune to commerce, regulations, taxes, trade, and restrictions of states. 18, Indian religious freedom and cultural integrity protected. 19, establishment of national Indian voting with local options, free national Indian organizations from governmental controls. And last, reclaim and affirm health, housing, employment, economic development, and education for all Indian people. Now, here's the preamble and complete text of the Trail of Broken Treaties, Point Indian Manifesto. These 20 points, 26 years later, state clearly what has to happen if there is to be protection of Native rights and a future free from the dictates of the country that surrounds the Native nation. These claims clearly reaffirm that Indian people are sovereign people. Despite the history and the accomplishments, AIM is difficult to identify for some people. It seems to stand for many things at once: the protection of treaty rights and the preservation of spirituality and culture. But what else? Unlike the American Civil Rights Movement, with which it has been compared, AIM has seen self-determination and racism differently. Desegregation was not a goal. Individual rights were not placed ahead of the preservation of Native nation sovereignty. At the 1971 AIM National Conference, it was decided that translating policy to practice meant building organizations, schools, and housing and employment services. In Minnesota, AIM's birthplace, that is exactly what was done. Over the years, as the organizations have grown, they have continued to serve the community from a base of Indian culture. Before AIM in 1968, culture had been weakened in most Indian communities due to U.S. policy, the American boarding schools, and all the other efforts to extinguish Indian secular and spiritual life. Now, many groups cannot remember the time without culture. This great revival has also helped to restore the spiritual leaders and elders to their former positions of esteem for the wisdom and the history they hold. All of these actions are in concert with the principles of AIM and came into being at this time in history because Indian people have refused to relinquish their sovereign right to exist as free and uncolonized people. Not the time that follows. 1968, Minneapolis AIM Patrol, created to address issues of extensive police brutality. 1969, Alcatraz Island, occupied for 19 months. AIM was there when United Indians of all tribes reclaimed federal land in the name of Native nations. First Indian radio broadcast, Radio Free Alcatraz, heard in the Bay Area of San Francisco. Indian Health Board of Minneapolis founded. This is the first Indian urban-based healthcare provider in the nation. 1970, Legal Rights Center, created to assist in alleviating legal issues facing Indian people. In 2007, over 19,000 clients have had legal representation thanks to AIM's founding of the Legal Rights Center. 1970 again, AIM takeover of abandoned property at the Naval Air Station near Minneapolis focuses attention on Indian education and leads to early grants for Indian education. Citizens' arrest of John Oldcrow. Takeover of the Bureau of Indian Affairs main office in Washington, D.C. to show improper BIA policies. 24 arrested for trespassing and released. BIA Commissioner Louis Bruce, who was a Mohawk, shows his AIM membership card at the meeting held after the release of those arrested. First National AIM Conference. 18 chapters of AIM convened to develop long-range strategy for future directions of the movement. Takeover of Dam. AIM assists the Lakota Ojibwe in Wisconsin in taking over a dam controlled by Northern States Power, which flooded much of the reservation land. This action leads to support by government officials and eventual settlement, returning over 25,000 acres of land to the tribe, and actually providing significant monies and business opportunities to the tribe. 1972, Little Red Schoolhouse, the second survival school to open, offering culturally based education services to K-12 students in St. Paul, Minnesota. Heart of the Earth Survival School, a K-12 school established to address the extremely high dropout rate among American Indian students and lack of cultural programming. Hot Test serves as the first model of community-based, student-centered education with culturally correct curriculum operating under the parental control. Trail of Broken Treaties. A March on Washington, D.C., ending in the occupation of BIA headquarters and resulting in the presentation of a 20-point solution paper to President Nixon. 1973, the year my son Antoine was born. Mm-hmm. Of course, the year 1972 is when I went to the BIA and left David, my oldest living son, home with his mother, who took care of the home campfires, so I could be there, and he was just an infant. To continue, legal action for school funds. In reaction to the Trail of Broken Treaties, the government abruptly canceled education grants to Heart of the Earth Survival School, Red Schoolhouse, and the Indian Community School of Milwaukee. Through successful legal action, the U.S. District Court orders the grants restored and government payment of costs and attorney fees. Wounded Knee 73, AIM was contacted by Lakota elders for assistance in dealing with the corruption within the BIA and Tribal Council, which led to the famed 71-day occupation and battle with the U.S. Armed Forces. 1974, International Indian Treaty Council, an organization representing Indian people throughout the Western Hemisphere at the UN in Geneva, Switzerland. Wounded Knee Trials. 8 months of trials in Minneapolis resulted from events which occurred during the 1973 Wounded Knee occupation. This was the longest federal trial in the history of the United States. Many instances of government misconduct were revealed with the result that U.S. District Judge Fred Nickel dismissed all charges due to government misconduct, which formed a pattern throughout the course of the trial, quote unquote, so that the waters of justice have been polluted. 1975, Federation of Survival Schools, created to provide advocacy and networking skills to 16 survival schools throughout the US and Canada. Little Earth of United Tribes, HUD, H-U-D, chose AIM to be the prime sponsor of the first Indian-run housing project. 1977, McGeezy Communications founded in Minneapolis. The organization is dedicated to produce Indian news and information and educate students of all ages as tomorrow's technical workforce. The International Indian Treaty Council establishes non-governmental organizations status within the United Nations in Geneva and attends the International Non-Governmental Organization Conference and presents testimony to the United Nations. American Indian Language and Culture Legislation. AIM introduces legislative language which is adopted, recognizing state responsibility for Indian education and culture. This legislation was recognized as a model throughout the country. 1978, first education programs for American Indian offenders. AIM establishes the first adult education program at Stillwater Prison in Minnesota. Programs later established at other state correctional facilities model after the Minnesota program. Circle of Life Survival School, established on the White Earth Indian Reservation in Minnesota. The school receives funding for 3 years of operation from the U.S. Department of Education. Run for Survival. AIM youth organize and conduct 500-mile run from Minneapolis to Lawrence, Kansas to support the Longest Walk. The Longest Walk. Indian nations walk across the U.S. from California to D.C. to protest anti-Indian legislation calling for the abrogation of treaties. A teepee is set up and maintained on the grounds of the White House. The proposed anti-Indian legislation is defeated. Women of all red nations won. Established to address issues directly facing Indian women and their families. 1979, Little Earth Housing Protected. An attempt by the U.S. Department of Housing and Urban Development to foreclose on the Little Earth of United Tribes housing project is halted by legal action and the U.S. District Court issues an injunction against HUD. American Indian Opportunities Industrialization Center creates job training schools to attack the outrageous unemployment issues of Indian people. Over 37,000 Native Americans have been trained for jobs since AIM created the American Indian Opportunities Industrialization Center in 1979. Anishinaabe Akin Organization is created to regain stolen and tax-forfeited land on the White Earth Reservation in Minnesota. 1984, Federation of Native Control Survival Schools presents legal education seminars for educators of Indian children at colleges and law schools in Minnesota, Wisconsin, California, South Dakota, Nebraska, and Oklahoma. National conference held in San Jose, California, concurrent with the National Indian Education Association Convention. 1986, schools lawsuit, Heart of the Earth and Red Schoolhouse successfully sued the U.S. Department of Education, Indian education programs for unfairly ranking the school's programs below funding recommendation levels. The schools provided bias in the system of ranking by the department staff. 1987, AIM Patrol, Minneapolis AIM Patrol comes full circle in restarting the patrol to deal with the serial killings of American Indian women in Minneapolis. 1988, Elaine Stately Indian Youth Services developed to create alternatives for youth as a direct diversion to gang involvement of Indian youth. Fort Snelling AIM annual powwow. With the 20th anniversary of AIM, an annual powwow was established at historic Fort Snelling. The event becomes the largest Labor Day weekend event in any Minnesota state park. 1989, spear fishing. AIM is requested to provide expertise in dealing with angry protesters on boat landings. Spearfishing continues despite violence, arrests, and threats from white racists. Senator Daniel Inouye calls for a study on the effects of Indian spearfishing. The study shows only 6% of fish taken are by Indians. Sports fishing accounts for all the rest. 1991, Peacemaker Center. With an American Indian spiritual base, AIM houses its AIM patrol and ESIYS in the center, in the heart of the Indian community. Sundance returned to Minnesota. With the support of the Dakota communities, a great spiritual rebirth took place at Pipestone, Minnesota. Ojibwe nations, too, have helped make the Minnesota Sundance possible. The Pipestone Sundance has since become an annual event. In 1991, leaders of the Oglala Lakota, Cheyenne, and other nations declared independence from the United States. The group established a provisional government and began the other work at developing a separate nation. National Coalition on Racism in Sports and Media was organized to address the use of Indians as sports team mascots. AIM led a walk in Minneapolis to the 1992 Super Bowl. In 1994, the Minneapolis Star Tribune agreed to stop using professional sports team names that referred to Indian people. 1992, the Food Connection organized summer youth jobs programs with an organic garden and spiritual camp, Common Ground, at Tonkawood Farm in Orono, Minnesota. 1993, expansion of American Indian OIC job training program. The Grand Metropolitan Incorporation of Great Britain, a parent of the Pillsbury Corporation, merges its job training program with that at AIOIC. The pledges and pledges future monies and support. Little Earth. After an 18-year struggle, HUD Secretary Cisneros rules that the Little Earth of United Tribes Housing Project shall retain the right to Indian preference. Wounded Knee Anniversary. Gathering for the 20th anniversary of the Wounded Knee Action, Oglala Sioux Tribal President thanks AIM for the 1973 actions. 1996, April 3rd to the 8th. As a representative of the American Indian Movement, Grand Governing Council, and Special Representative of the International Indian Treaty Council, Vernon Belcourt, along with William A. Means, both who have passed since, President of the IITC, attended the preparatory meeting for the Intercontinental Encounter for Humanity and Against Neoliberalism, hosted by the Emiliano Zapata Liberation Group, held in La Realidad in the Lancandon rainforest of eastern Chiapas, Mexico. This is the time of the NAFTA. July 27th to August 3rd, 1996. The second meeting for the Intercontinental Encounter for Humanity and Against Neoliberalism was again hosted by the EZLN, and was attended by delegates of the International Indian Treaty Council and the American Indian Movement. 1998, February 27th, the 25th anniversary of Wounded Knee and Lakota, Oglala Lakota Nation resolution established February 27th as a National Day of Liberation. July 16th to the 19th, 25th Annual Lakota Ray Honor the Earth Homecoming Celebration to celebrate and honor the people of Lakota Ray and the American Indian Movement who participated in the July 31st, 1971 takeover of the Winter Dam and the birth of Honor the Earth. August the 2nd to the 11th, 30th anniversary of the American Indian Movement, Grand Governing Council. Sacred Pipestone Quarries in Pipestone, Minnesota, welcoming feast and celebration and conference commemorating AIM's 30th anniversary. February 1999, three activists working with a group of UOWA Indians in Colombia, kidnapped by rebels. Ingrid Washinawatak, 41 years old, Menominee, the humanitarian, and Terrence Freitas, 24, an environmental scientist in Santa Cruz, California, and Oene Oege, 39, of Hawaii, were seized near the village of Royota in Arauca province in northeastern Colombia on Thursday, February 25th, while preparing to leave the territory of the UOA after a two-week on-site visit. Ingrid Lahe and Terrence were kidnapped on February 25th by armed gunmen in UOA in the territory of northeastern Colombia. On March 5th, they brutalized and bullet-riddled bodies were discovered across the border in Venezuela. July 2000, AIM's 32nd anniversary conference on the Lakota Ojibwe Nation Reservation in northern Wisconsin. October 2000, Commission to Seek Justice for Ingrid Washinawatak and Companions established. March 2001, representatives of the American Indian Movement, Grand Governing Council, attend the Zapatista Army of National Liberation March for Peace, Justice, and Dignity, Zocalo Plaza, Mexico City. July 2001, 11th Annual Youth and Elders International Cultural Gathering and Sundance at Pipestone, Minnesota. August of that year, civil lawsuit for false arrest brought by five anti-Wahoo demonstrators against the city of Cleveland. November of that year, the American Indian Forum on Racism in Sports and Media, Black Bear Crossing in South St. Paul, Minnesota. August of 2002, 12th Annual International Youth and Elders Cultural Gathering and Sundance, Pipestone, Minnesota. May of 2003, quarterly meeting of the AIM National Board of Directors, Thunderbird House, Winnipeg, Manitoba. August of that year, 13th Annual International Youth and Elders Cultural Gathering and Sundance at Pipestone, Minnesota. August of 2004, 14th Annual International Youth and Elders Cultural Gathering and Sundance, Honor Your Grandparents, Wisdom Keeper of Tomorrow, Pipestone, Minnesota. May of 2005, First Annual Clyde H. Belcourt Endowment Scholarship Fund First Annual Clyde H. Belcourt Endowment Scholarship Fund and Awards Banquet, period. At the Minneapolis Convention Center. July 2005, 15th Annual International Youth and Elders Cultural Gathering and Sundance, International Prayer Vigil for the Earth at Pipestone, Minnesota. May 2006, Second Annual Clyde H. Belcourt Endowment Scholarship Fund and Awards Banquet at the Minneapolis Convention Center. In July of 2006, 16th Annual International Youth and Elders Cultural Gathering and Sundance, again at Pipestone, Minnesota. That's a lengthy timeline, but most of those events that are mentioned, I had read about while they were going on, because for many years since the time that AIM started, just about, there was a wonderful newspaper that started at Akwesasne, New York. It was called Akwesasne Notes. That had a tremendous amount of impact on myself, my attitudes, and my perceptions, because I was kept well informed right along every step. Mainstream media didn't even cover it, or if they did, it was in an